Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us this week. I am Dawn Williams. I serve as the Dean of the School of Education at Howard University, and we are officially kicking off American Education Week, in which we have recoined to be Bison Education Week. And I'm so excited that we have a dear colleague that is helping us to kick off our series. So each day this week, we are hosting a brown bag lecture that is free to anyone that wants to come in and join and learn something. It could be that this is the break that you might have, and children might be at recess, or this might be your lunch break. But if you happen to be on campus tomorrow, it is our only in-person event. And it will be, again, from 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock in room 130 of the School of Education. So if you happen to come by, you actually can join us with a quick bite to eat, as well as a drop of some strong knowledge. And we expect nothing less today with Dr. Gregory Hutchings Jr. So during Bison Education Week, our intent is to uplift the banner of education. We intend to ensure that you are familiar with all sectors of this profession, the most wonderful profession, that you are going to learn something each week. You're going to help us to celebrate and acknowledge all of the heroes out there that are educators in all of their forms. Because we are a school of education, we want to ensure that there is some knowledge that you are picking up in the midst of the celebration, and hoping that it's going to help you to be a stronger educator and do what you do to have a greater impact. So for this series, we are having a forum Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, again from 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock. On Thursday, our students are facilitating and leading community service. And our Friday is our day of giving. So if you feel compelled, please, please be sure to support our students. On Friday, our day of giving, any contribution that is tax deductible that you make will go directly to student scholarships. So please know that you are making a difference with anything that you can do. So follow us on social media for all of the accolades. Each day we're highlighting different sectors of the profession. So please like and love and give us reactions so that we can spread the love of the work that our great educators do. But today we have a special treat. We have our first workshop series featuring Dr. Gregory Hutchings. You all may know him as being a superintendent of two school districts. He is local to the area in Washington, D.C., and because of that, we have the opportunity to work with him as an adjunct faculty member. But right now, he is the founder and chief executive officer of Revolutionary Ed, LLC. He is a nationally recognized educational leader, anti-racism activist, and published author, who unapologetically advocates for Black, Indigenous, and people of color and racial equity in education. Dr. Hutchings proudly serves as an adjunct faculty member when we need him to, and students are delighted to have that opportunity. And he also was recently appointed as the first executive in residence at American University's School of Education. His life's work is educational leadership and dismantling systemic racism in schools across America. He has received numerous awards for his educational work and leadership, including most recently the 2022-23 Region 4 Superintendent of the Year Award with the Virginia Association of School Superintendents. And he was the 2018 recipient of the Joseph E. Hill Superintendent of the Year from the National Alliance of Black School Educators. He has over 20 years of combined educational experience as a college admissions counselor, a teacher, school principal, central office administrator, superintendent, and college professor. So he has done it all. He specializes in anti-racism in education, educational leadership, strategic planning, strategic thinking, professional learning, school board and superintendent relations, and executive coaching. And I would be remiss to not say that he is a brother of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. as we like to include in our introductions, as he noted, my crimson and cream that I'm wearing today. So with that, Dr. Hutchings, we welcome you to our lecture series for Bison Education Week, and we look forward to hearing more from you and at the end, engaging in some discussion.
All right, thank you so much, Dean Williams, and it is always a pleasure to be in your presence. I mean, you are a hero, not just a shero, but a hero, especially for, you know, this fight that we are doing in education right now across America. So Howard University, I have to say, is near and dear to my heart. My father is a graduate of Howard University, class of 77. He was in the School of Business. And he's deceased now, but I know how proud he would be every time I speak at Howard or I'm a part of the faculty. I just know that he is shining down and just saying, well done, for sure. So I'm very honored for that. So let's get right into this. You know, I like to, let me tell you, I'm gonna share my screen because I get excited about this work. Cause I said, you know, Dean Williams, she mentioned this earlier, this truly is like my life passion. What we're doing right now, what I'm doing right now in regards to trying to work with school systems and organizations to dismantle systemic racism in education, it is bold, it is like crazy, it is exciting, it's sad, it's emotional, it's all those things, right? But I know that is exactly what I've been put on this earth to do for the rest of my life, and I am fulfilling my life goal. So I'm pleased for that. Before we get started, I do want to just have you all put in the chat, because we can't go through everybody. It's a lot of folks, and that takes up too much time. But I want to just kind of hear where you all are from in the chat. And because it's lunchtime, I want to know what's your favorite food combination, because I like French fries and ice cream. I don't know if y'all do, but they got to be McDonald's fries hot with a sundae. I can eat that. Very rarely, but I do it. That's like my crazy combination. And right now for my self-care, I have been working out. I have a personal trainer. And then I also work out on my own. I've lost 20 pounds during the pandemic, which is great. I'm in the best shape of my life. I'm trying to get back to my grown and sexy days in my 20s. Telling my wife, she like, you could do that. Now I ain't nothing to do with me. Don't be putting that on me. I said, I ain't putting it on you. You look good exactly how you are, right? But I'm trying to get back to my 20s. So put out there, folks, like just where you're from, what's your favorite food combination? What you're doing right now for some self-care. I just want to hear from you. Put in the chat, and then we're going to get started because this gets heavy, right? So we got to start off with a little bit of laughter, right? We got to fill our cups before we begin to start going. So don't go too soon. I see Jeremiah typing something. I want to see it pop up. You're thinking too hard. I see you, that's right, Brooklyn, of course, Cleveland, Ohio, all right. Jeremiah Surratt. Lunchtime combo, pot, I missed it. It went too fast. Let me go back up. Pot stickers with soy sauce. Okay, I see that. I forgot Chicago, wings and fries, working out, walking with music, seafood. Oh, I hope you like crabs, Rashana. Real crabs. We like real crabs up here, right from the wharf. You can call them in and pick them up now. Washington, D.C., Wendy's fries and frosty. They're my favorite. Wendy's fries and frosty. Crab legs, oh shoot, what? I am shocked. Well, you all just keep it coming in. We're gonna go ahead and get started because I do like to center this conversation around why I do this work. I mean, I told you I'm doing my life's passion, but I like to start off and talk about me and my brother, right? My little brother, 4 years younger than I am. I talk about me and my brother for the simple fact that we have the same parents. We grew up in the same household. We have the same adverse childhood, or many of the same adverse childhood experiences. However, when I was serving as superintendent just this summer, because I just left the superintendency on August 31st, my brother was in the Alexandria City Jail waiting for his hearing for a federal crime that he committed and for his sentencing, right? So I'm in the same city, brother, who was locked up, going to serve 5 years in federal prison because he got sentenced since. And I'm the superintendent of Alexandria City Public Schools. And I start with that because as my brother has gone through, he's made some choices in his life and I know he's going to do better, right? I still have faith in him. I still know he's going to do well. I still support my brother 100%. You know, I'm disappointed in some of the choices he's made, but he's my brother and he's family first. But one thing I used to ask him was, what was the difference between your walk and my walk? And one thing that really stuck out to me was he said that, you know, when you were in school or when we were in school, you always had educators that believed in you and I didn't. In sixth grade, his teacher told him he was going to amount to nothing. Teacher has never told me that throughout my entire career. I always had Black women in my life, teachers in my life. Didn't have a lot of Black men in my life, but I had Black women in my life from kindergarten all the way through 12th grade, who always kind of gave me that additional boost that I needed to be successful. And that was one thing that he was lacking. So one thing that I know is the power of educators. Sometimes we forget how powerful our words are, good and bad. You know, a learning environment that is conducive for young folks, especially Black males and Black females to learn in, is going to be essential in order for us to change this narrative for futures to come. So I like to start with just centering my truth, which is my brother, who I love and adore, my only brother. I got one brother and one sister. Our sister's older. And yes, he's made some choices, but the system has failed him in a lot of ways. In a whole lot of ways, because he could have had a very different life. So my job is to talk with you all today to make sure we don't have other young folks like my brother James, right? I have to go through that walk. So I want to get right into it. And I know that was kind of, you probably like, dang, you start off with that, now you just get right into educational disparities. Yep, because I want you all to understand what's happening nationally. You all probably already know all this because you were at HU or you're part of HU, right? So first and foremost, we know that there are disparities when it comes to college and career right now across this nation. There was a report that Ed Trust has put out a couple of years ago. So it's a little, you know, dated right now, but it's still very, it's timely for what I'm talking about today. One in particular, when we talk about career and college readiness, we know that across this entire nation, Black and Latino students, they are overlooked, right, when it comes to advanced placement courses, whether it's access, whether it is preparation, whether it's foundational skills, whether it's the necessary supports, whether it's even a belief that they can actually be in these courses. It is happening in schools across the entire United States of America right now. And it is going to be imperative for us to begin to address this, not at the high school level only. We got to start addressing this early. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that today. We know that there are a lot of Black and Brown students who are part of the career technical education courses. However, what we're seeing is that they're not in these courses where they're able to get certificate programs or certificates so they can go out and get a career afterwards. And we have to make sure that we are setting up pathways for that to happen in our schools. Another quick tidbit is equity and diversity in our learning environments. We are, and I'm tired of saying the statistic, but it is a reality. Our Black and Brown children are being suspended, expelled, and put out of school at, you know, exacerbated rates in comparison to their white counterparts, period, right? We also know, and this is the research that's showing this, adult biases influence our discipline decisions. So we have majority of white woman population in our schools across America. That is who our teachers are, majority white women, right? Who may have biases, good or bad, that they bring to the table that influence some of the decisions that they're making when they're dealing with our Black and Brown children. The civil rights data collection just recently, it just pointed out the fact that you all probably already know this, but only 15% of our schools are enrolled with Black students nationwide. Now, if you're in DC, I mean, you're in DC, so you only see, think it's all Black. Well, the country don't look like DC. So we can't, that's your only point of reference right now. But our country is only 15% of our schools are in compromised, you know, Black students. And 40% are of these students who are expelled are Black. 40%, I'm sorry, who are suspended from school are Black. 35% are expelled. 36% are arrested within our schools. And this is across the entire nation. It gets even larger when you're talking about our urban school systems. You get to 100% in some of them. Some of our urban cities across this nation right now, right? It is like crazy. It's crazy, but it's real. These are true facts. It's from the Civil Rights Data Collection. And then finally, as we know, and let me just say, Howard University, I am so thankful that you all produce so many Black and Brown educators across this nation. HBCUs literally, and this is a fact, folks, HBCUs produce 50% of Black teachers in America. HBCUs, they produce 50% of Black teachers in America. So what that is saying right now, if we want to change this narrative, our schools of educations across our HBCUs, we're going to have to make sure that they are top-notch like Howard, like we are putting in the best professors, we have the best curriculum, and that we are preparing them to go out into this world to be equity warriors so that we can truly change this narrative. Because right now, Black and Latino students, they attend schools and they never see a person that looks like them. You know, our HBCUs are doing a great job. They're producing 50% of our Black teachers. However, still not enough. Some schools still don't have them. Some white kids don't even have a Black or Latino teacher, which is important. You know, we talk about biases. It's going to be easier to have that bias if you don't have a Black or brown person in your room. The only Black and brown people you might see may be a custodian or a cafeteria worker. So now that's your point of reference, right? Now you think that's all Black and brown people can do as a white person who may grow up. And that becomes your bias, right? You're not used to seeing anybody in a leadership role or in a professional, you know, setting, which is unfortunate. But we can change that with a lot of hard work. So let me just talk to you today of why I'm here. And that is, let's talk about getting into good trouble. One, it is my book. Gotta have a copy. Always do my shameless plug on that. Getting into Good Trouble at School. It's a guide to building an anti-racist school system. It is available on my website. I'll put the link in. Buy it on my website, not on Amazon. I say that because I'm a Black-owned business and we need to put our Black dollars. I'm a reseller of my book. So I wanna make sure that the publisher does not get all of the dollars. I resell my own book on my site to my constituents. But I'll put the link in there for you. But I wanna start with the Honorable Congressman, the late and great John Lewis. He had his quote, you know, that resonated with me, in particular when George Floyd was murdered before America, was when this resonated most. But he talked about getting into good trouble, and he said it had to be necessary trouble. And the simple fact that if we got into this necessary trouble, it would help us to redeem the soul of America. Like redeem this, that's how powerful that it can be if we do good trouble. I'm not telling folks to go out and get into just any kind of trouble. We gotta be very intentional with our efforts and what we are trying to do. And I wanna share with you today just six easy steps. I'm not gonna say easy, six steps to getting into good trouble at school. And we're gonna go right into each one of these. Number one, it's so important for every single one of us when we are working with our Black and brown students across America that we know our history. Everybody right now is so fearful of even saying the word critical race theory. CRT, it has been so politicized that people don't even know the true meaning of it. What critical race theory really is about, folks, it is about making the connection between our history and what is happening today, that race is a social construct that was created to make Black and brown people feel inferior to white people, and that the results we have today were intentional. That is all critical race theory is doing. I mean, that's simple. At first, I used to be like, oh, we're not doing critical race theory. Oh, until I learned about it, I'm like, oh, shoot, I'm a critical race theorist. I am. Because what's happening in our schools, in our businesses, in our neighborhoods is intentional. It was meant to be what it is right now. It's happening. If we don't know our history, meaning if we do not learn about how our cities were developed, learn about the history of our schools and our school divisions, you know, knowing about who had to really struggle to make a way for you if you are a Black and a brown leader right now, who paved that way for you? Right? Who made it possible for you to be in the role that you're in right now? If you don't know that, how are you going to be able to prevent history from repeating itself? And this is why folks want to stop us from teaching their true history. And that's the good, the bad, and the ugly. You know, if you begin to teach our young Black children about their true history and how we really come from kings and queens from Africa and what we had to endure over 400 years, generations of slavery and what we've endured, imagine how powerful that will make our young Black children feel today if they knew that. Is it hurtful? Absolutely, it's hurtful, but it's also, it's like, wow, you know what, if they can endure that, I can endure anything. It makes you feel like you can achieve. It makes you feel like you are somebody, right? It makes you feel that you do come from, even though it's not a rich, you know, solid history all the time, sometimes there's some negative things that are in our history and some horrible, horrific things that are in our history. It's still our history and it makes us who we are today. That's why we are, I believe, in the Black race, some of the most forgiving people on this earth. I truly believe that. But if you don't know your history and if you don't establish routines and structures, you're not going to be able to dismantle those inequities. Number two, you got to commit to racial equity. And I'm not talking about equity. You know, folks, we talk about equity. We want to bring in, and let me tell you, let me just make my disclaimer. I'm not knocking LGBTQ or special education or anything like that. But a lot of times when we talk about equity, we want to say, well, let's focus on our LGBTQ, or let's focus on our special ed, or let's focus on our, you know, our discipline, right? No, let's focus on race. Race is the core issue. When you put race to our LGBTQ population, those issues or challenges are exacerbated. You put race to special education, so you say you're a Black special ed student, you have now exacerbated whatever that challenge is. Anytime you add race to any one of our issues and challenges across this nation right now, it just exacerbates it. So let us hit the core. Let's really focus on the racial equity, you know, the simple fact that right now, unfortunately, race can predict some people's future. It should not be a predictor of what you can and can't do. That's crazy, right? We have to challenge the predominant paradigms that are happening across this nation. And it depends on what school system you're in. I can use my former school system when, you know, and I'm a product of Alexandria City Public Schools too, where I was superintendent. Our predominant, you know, group was our white affluent families. They really pretty much were making a lot of the rules for Alexandria City Public Schools. I mean, not under my leadership, but prior to my arrival. And our majority population that we served was Black and brown, low income. So if we're allowing that predominant group or dominant group to make the decisions for the majority of the population that we serve, and they're not a part of that group, then we are doing a disservice to majority of our students. So it doesn't mean that you don't listen. I'm not saying that you mute anybody. Everybody deserves to have a seat at the table. I do believe that. You need to make sure though, when you're making your decisions, that your decisions are being made on behalf of majority of your population. That is gonna be key, or you're gonna fail your kids all the time, right? We have to make sure we're promoting that racial literacy and racial fluency. Racial literacy is knowing specifically what these different terms are. What is a microaggression? What is a bias, right? What is anti-racism? What does equity mean for us? So you gotta define that. Racial fluency is knowing when to use it. That's knowing how to be methodical and strategic with your approach, right? Just knowing a bunch of words and a bunch of definitions and having that glossary is not enough. Do people know how to use these terms appropriately and know when to take action, right? And that is what that racial fluency is all about. You gotta have both in order to be successful and to get into that good trouble that I'm talking about. Step three, eliminating de facto segregation. And I specifically call it de facto segregation. In the book, we call it detracking. I like to call it de facto segregation because really what we're doing when we have our honors programs that require you to have certain guidelines to get in, or you have to meet certain prerequisites to take an AP course, or you are putting certain students in special education, right? And there's this pathway that all of a sudden it seems like you got all these Black boys in this one path of being emotionally disturbed in your school system. And like 100% of the boys are Black, which is like crazy. These are forms of de facto segregation. Right? If you go and you look at your history, you will see most likely in almost every one of your school systems that special education started in your school system probably in the late 60s, early 70s, when schools began to integrate. And you're going to see a correlation with integration of your schools and starting special education programs and talented and gifted programs. That was done intentionally to separate Black and white children. If we're going to have to integrate, we're going to put some of these Black kids in special ed and we're going to put our white kids in tech. And then it became a thing. right? And that is how systems, unfortunately, in many schools right now are still operating. That's why you see majority of your talented and gifted programs, even in a predominantly Black school system, being predominantly white. Because these systems and structures were created that way. If you don't know that history, how are you going to be able to dismantle that? But these are very key points that you got to do. Step four, differentiate between discipline and policing. I'm not speaking of SROs in schools, right? I've been through down that path, right? I've been done it as superintendent. I am not even gonna make a comment about it. I'm gonna let your school system figure out what you're gonna do for SROs. But I will tell you that when you're talking about discipline in your schools, we need to make sure we're doing restorative practices, right? We're trying to restore behavior so that you can assimilate back into our learning environments. And instead of pushing our Black and brown children out of school, how do you make sure that they have the necessary support so that they can be in school, right? And that is making sure we have psychologists and social workers and counselors in our school buildings and having, you know, not just adequate, but having enough folks to handle the workload. Kids have been through trauma. You all know with this pandemic, folks, we have been trapped in our homes for a year, figuring out when to wear masks, when not to wear masks. I got to get my vaccine. You know, we have all been through trauma over the past 3 years. And now we're able to experience what many of our Black and brown children have been doing prior to this global pandemic. They've been in trauma nonstop. Just being Black or brown in America, unfortunately, is traumatic. So welcome to our world now. Folks are now seeing that being locked in your house and not being able to do the stuff that you want to do. Well, guess what? That's what Black and brown people feel all the time for different reasons. So let's do something about this and make sure that we're doing restorative practices. We also need to challenge these zero tolerance policies that are across America. A lot of those zero tolerance policies impacted Black and brown children in a very negative way, right? It also created biases around Black and brown children. So we got to make sure that we're working through that. You know, one quick story about discipline. I remember I was doing a tour of a school. It was a charter network. Won't tell you the city, but we were in the school. Kids were walking down the halls, hands behind their backs, looking on the floor, right? The principal was so excited. He was like, look how quiet they are. They got their hands behind their backs. They're looking on the floor. And I said, I'm sorry. I said, I have to say something. This is, you know, a white principal who was excited about this. And I said, I'm sorry, but I find this very insulting, and it's not appropriate. Kids should not be walking down the halls, one with their hands behind their backs and looking down on the floor. I said, those are similar patterns that you see in a prison. That's how prisoners, inmates, are moved from one cell to the next. And now we're already producing a pipeline because we're giving them a mindset that you walk with your hands behind your back and you look on the floor, and that's a celebration of being obedient. Those words need to be out of our vocabulary. Tamed, obedient, that's slavery times. Those days are over, folks. Right? We got to make sure we're challenging folks when they're using that kind of language and those practices in our school buildings and complimenting one another about it. We got these kids under control. That's crazy, right? That's a slave mentality, but we can get into a whole nother situation. And I got to get through these steps. Next is engaging in strategic thinking and strategic planning. I'm putting an emphasis on and. Because your strategic thinking is a skill. It is a skill that anybody can learn. Some people are blessed and born with it, right? Some people are just strategic thinkers from the moment they come out of the womb. Some folks have to learn, right? You got to learn how to be a strategic thinker. And strategic planning is your roadmap, right? It is how you're going to get to whatever destination you're trying to or whatever goals you are trying to achieve, right? That is what your strategic plan is about. And they go hand in hand. Without a strategic plan, so if anybody out there doesn't have one, I don't know where you're going. Like, how would you know what you were supposed to be doing in within your organization if you don't have one, right? Your strategic thinking comes in play because you're going to have to now navigate these uncharted waters, especially if you're trying to get into some good trouble at school, right? You're going to have to know who I need to put out in front of this audience to say what needs to be said. It might not be me. When I was superintendent, I couldn't always be the messenger. Because people weren't going to receive it from me. But I could have someone who did not look like me use the exact same talking points, and the crowd is clapping and cheering, and they don't even realize they just clap and cheer for everything I believe in. Because somebody else delivered that message. That's what a strategic thinker does. You make sure that you're catering and customizing for your audience. you're making sure that you're clearly articulating what your timeline is, so that when you are trying to, you know, push a certain policy forward or get funding for a particular initiative, that people understand why and why there is a sense of urgency, right? So this is why it's going to be so important for you to get into some good trouble by engaging in the strategic plan and making sure that you are a strategic thinker along the way. And then six is probably, I think, one of the most important steps of getting into good trouble at school. And that is displaying courage and bold leadership, or courageous and bold leadership. You are going to encounter going into, you know, or getting into good trouble at school. You're going to encounter some pushback. You're going to encounter, and I'm just speaking from my own walk, threats. You're going to encounter situations where folks are like, you know, I thought I was going to be on your team, but now I'm scared and I'm going to leave you by yourself. So you're going to be lonely, right? You're going to have to still have that courageous and bold leadership and do what you have been signed up to do. One thing that I see time and time again, I see our Black and Brown leaders, they get into these roles and they play it so safe that they don't get the work done. And I'm not saying that you can't be a strategic thinker, because you do got to be strategic and you got to be savvy with how you're going to execute, you know, some of your goals. But you have to stay true to your mission. Our kids are relying on us. How many more children have to be failed? Right? I can tell you right now, there is a shortage of Black and Brown leaders across this nation. So you might not have the job here, but you're going to get another one. Trust me, you will. You might have to move, but you could get another one. You really can. And I would rather lose my job standing for something versus standing for nothing and ruining thousands and thousands of more children. We got to be that bold. I mean, and I ain't telling nobody to lose their life, right? I ain't asking you to be a martyr for America. Or for Black America, or for Brown America. But I'm saying you do have to be true to what you signed up for and what you said you were going to do. That's where it comes. You know, I always talk about VIP, and it's not vision, integrity. I'm sorry, it's not very important people. It's vision, it's integrity, it's passion, right? If you don't have that vision of seeing beyond today and that integrity of standing for something you said you were going to do and that passion that gets you up every day to come back and fight this very difficult fight every moment, then you think you may need to think of something else to do. It's not the right business for you. It's just not. And we got to be that serious. Even in our schools of education, we have to make sure that we are producing these pre-service teachers and leaders so that they know what they're getting into, so that they're prepared to make sure that they can fight against these, you know, the storm and overcome some of these obstacles. Then you got to do all this. And this is my final slide. And I want to open the floor with some questions, because I know you all have some. You got to do all this, and then you got to deal with Black fatigue. And I'm just going to speak to, I don't know if you all have heard of this book, Black Fatigue. It's by Mary Frances Winters. It literally changed my life in allowing me to have language for what I have felt for so many years. I didn't understand why I was fatigued. I didn't understand why I was irritated when people, sometimes if I had a white person ask me like, are you okay? Or what can I do to help? And I would get irritated by that. I didn't understand, because they were really being nice, but I didn't understand why. I was like, why do you keep asking me? Like, I wanted to go off about it, right? And I realized from reading this book that as Black people, we're fatigued. We are constantly asked to solve problems that we did not create. And that is difficult. We are constantly having to be in defense mode. We are constantly having to deal with the fact that we work just as hard, in a lot of cases harder, but we don't get the same respect, or we don't get the same opportunities, or we don't get the same break. We don't get the same kind of like pass on certain things, right? We don't get do-overs. You get your one shot, and if you can't make it, then you're done in some cases. And it's fatiguing, and there's nothing we can do about it, right? It's like we can't change other people's behaviors. We can only be responsible for our own. And that's tiring, right? It is very fatiguing. And one thing that we have to do, that I know we can do, is we can continue to build our own capacity, take those risks when we are in positions of power so that we do have a voice. Please do not, muddle your voice. You need to speak up, right? You need to be louder when you get into these roles, right? Not quieter. Make sure that you are empowering others and that you're providing the professional learning to build professional capacity so that everybody around you can do this work with you and you're not the only person out here fighting this battle alone. We got to develop some equity warriors. So I know I kind of like gave a lot, but I didn't have a lot of time, right? I could teach this all day, which I have modules that go along with my six steps of getting into good trouble. And there's six full day modules that I've now created that I'm now going across this country to do, because it's a lot of work that needs to be done in order for us to truly get into some good trouble at school. And my job is to try to give people the skill set so that they can, fight this good fight. Here's the website you all can visit. You can learn more about, Revolutionary Ed. Also, you can purchase the book on this site. And I'm going to stop here so that I can open the floor for questions for you all. And I'm going to start reading them because I couldn't see all these questions before because I was on my screen share. But you all were busy. You all were busy. I'm so glad you said something. Challenge the predominant paradigms. Yes. Actually, you are truly a delight. I'm so happy to hear you speak my self-care. Yeah, yoga. I love you doing. And hula hoop. Shoot. Okay. So what questions will you all be doing? I don't know about the recording. I think it is recording because I pressed yes to it. But Dean Williams, will people get copies of this session?
Yes, we will certainly. We know that there were people who could not join us today, but wanted to be able to view it at a later time. So yes, we will. You can feel free to put your questions in the chat, or you could unmute yourself and ask a question. I have a question, but I'm going to give some wait time so that my community could chime in.
What does professional learning for individuals seeking PD on anti-racism look like? So for one, let me just tell you, anybody who's doing professional learning on anti-racism, such as myself, you got to start with establishing some norms. And that's the first thing, establishing those norms that everybody's going to agree to and how you engage. I use the four agreements, that's through courageous conversations, if you're not familiar with those. But establishing those types of norms and making sure that people are developing a safe and brave space to really start having some courageous conversations. And the first two modules, or first 2 days, is learning, but it's also building that rapport and those relationships. And then also what's gonna be key to professional learning for individuals seeking PD on anti-racism and what that should look like is there has to be action planning embedded into the professional learning. Meaning, one, it cannot be sit and get, right? If you were sitting and getting, nobody's gonna really listen. So there has to be engagement and activities, and then there has to be some action planning. For my professional learning sessions, I have workbooks that go along with that. That's guiding all the participants, along the way to ensure that they're like capturing their moments, because you have aha moments that you might forget. So in the professional learning, you have opportunities to capture your own self-reflection as well as group reflections. And I think that is a key component when you're doing any type of professional learning. So thank you for that question, Dr. Wade. Wyatt, is it Wyatt? All right, let's see if there are any other questions that are coming through.
I can chime in and ask a question while others okay. are conjuring up their questions. And part of your presentation, you had described a moment where you were able to observe students walking in a line that was similar to what we see in jails and prisons, which is unfortunate. Many times when we see that circumstance, the leaders of those schools are people of color. So that has me going back to think about Carter G. Woodson's The Miseducation of the Negro and how we tend to replicate how we were taught, as an example. So in this sort of journey and voyage of getting into good trouble, how do you advise educators of color work with other educators of color when they see that they are part of the problem in this manner?
Yes, and I'm glad you brought that up, Dean Williams. I think that a lot of times, even in predominantly Black, you know, school systems, meaning faculty and leaders are predominantly Black too, people don't realize it's the system. So not only is it your experience, it's also the systems too. Many of our systems were developed to be racist. So if you are adopting these systems and not actually dismantling them, you're just perpetuating some of those racist acts and practices that were put in place prior to your tenure. So that's why it's so important to dismantle the system as well as, you know, learning more about yourself. And I think that that's a very key component to making sure that you can get into good trouble. I also think that it's very important for us as Black educators that, you know, we do things where, and this is a part of the training that I provide, finding out where you are as an individual and knowing. So I use what, I don't know if you all have heard of IDI, it's called the Intercultural Development Inventory. And it will, I administer those anytime I start professional learning so that individuals and groups know where they kind of lie on the continuum, whether they're in denial or whether they are already accomplished and ready to embrace other cultures. But what we find a lot of times, what I found with people who have participated in the Intercultural Development Inventory is that they're shocked where they fall on the continuum, and especially Black people. They don't realize that there's unconscious bias that we have too from our own experiences. And what I try to do is, and what I hope others will do too, is try to unpack that. So then you can start really focusing on not just you, but also that system. So you can see why it's racist and why you can't repeat it and how not to repeat that. All right. We got wait time in here. We're all educators, so we can wait to see what you got to say.
How would you recommend school leaders to support school teams who are used to a traditional approach to dealing with behavior or disciplining students versus trying to shift to a more restorative opportunity?
Great question, and thank you. You know, one thing that I know I did as superintendent is I would always use examples with staff. And let me give you one prime example I would use. Everybody has a staff member that comes in late, right, to work. And some of them are repeatedly late to work. We always know who's going to be late. And you got to cover their class before they get in. Always say, so what if I had zero tolerance for your tardiness and you lose your job? Today, you're late, you're done. Right? I start applying some of these strategies that we use in our traditional, meaning you don't get a second chance in the traditional discipline world, right? What if I start applying that to your day-to-day work? Because you get passes every day at work. You all get passes every single day, right? You get do-overs. Even with some of our, and think of some of your most challenged employees, they still get chance after chance after chance and still working in there, whether they have a union that's keeping them in there or you're just a forgiving person allowing them to keep coming back. So let's start applying some of that same empathy to our students. Also, I think it's going to be important to make sure students have a voice. What is very powerful is when, especially when you're talking about restorative practices, is having sessions where students are able to speak to what they think, you know, they should be offered in regards to disciplinary consequences, or what's the best way to react and respond to them. You know, and another thing I think is important too, is making sure that you are modeling some of those practices. You know, it is very healthy to have, I mean, just think of when I start off this session today, I said, tell me a city or state that you're from, your combo food, and some self-care, right? But really that was like a kind of like a community circle. You're starting off with just something that is irrelevant to what we were doing today, right? But it's allowing us to get to know one another. And if you're doing that consistently, you begin to learn things about each other and have empathy and understanding around one another that you're willing, you know, to not follow those same traditional patterns that we have followed for so many years. So I hope, Rashonda, that helped respond to your question. Thank you. As a superintendent, how do you groom principals to be equity warriors so that they groom teachers and students and families who are equity warriors? I think the main thing you're going to first need to have is a professional learning plan. And it cannot be a one-time deal where you do, we're going to do a workshop and now everybody's equity warriors, right? You're going to have to really build professional capacity on a consistent basis. And in order for it to be sustainable and transformational, it's going to have to be continuous improvement. And one thing that is another key piece is making sure when you are developing these equity warriors who may happen to be principals, that you are also putting into those evaluations of those principals of what an equity warrior looks like, certain characteristics. So that, you know, a lot of time we're all educators. So a lot of educators, we like to get A's, right? We want to be the best at what we can do. And this is why I always believe with evaluation, it shouldn't be a gotcha moment. Everything should be laid out of, if you want an A or you want exemplary rating, right? These are all the characteristics you should have. And these are all the things you should do on a consistent basis, right? Put that out up front for folks. And people will rise to that occasion, but you can't just lay it out there. You also have to support them to get there. So somebody might not be able to be at that, you know, off the bat, they're not able to be exemplary, but you got to put in, you know, support systems and mechanisms so that you can build their professional capacity so they can make or attain, you know, that level that they're seeking. And I think that's something that can work with not just principals, but you know, all educators. So I hope that that helped with your question, Zakiya. All right, I see some other folks are nice. This is a way to have lunch today. Right. This is a real brown bag lunch, Dean Williams, and I'm glad I was able to kick it off because I'm ready. I'm like, I could do this all week. I see Camilla. I think she came on. She may have a question. I don't know. I just saw her face. I didn't see Camilla before. And now I'm putting you on blast.
Well, it was more of a comment where I said in the chat that I really appreciated your acknowledgement of Black fatigue. And it's even real when you're not in white spaces that oftentimes having to express this to others who don't necessarily have the awareness of struggle in their consciousness can also be very tiring, particularly around Blacks and people of color who've kind of made it and don't necessarily see the struggles of those that are air quotes, you know, the least of us. So I appreciate, you know, just that you've given me some language to think about it or given us language.
Right. And you're right. You know what? It happens even in Black spaces. It's not just white spaces that this does happen. It can happen on the campus of Howard University, right? Which is the Mecca. And I, you know, I think that the more we're able to find that language, the better we're able to process it. And that's why I felt like the book was, you know, was life-changing for me because I just didn't have the language. I have the feelings. You know, I have kind of like what, you know, my reactions are to certain things, but I had to start understanding, okay, well, some of these things are normal. Now, how can I make sure I work through that so it doesn't manifest into a certain behavior, right? That I'm not cussing somebody out, right? Something crazy like that. I don't want to be popping off with, you know, saying some crazy stuff. So this allowed me to like really work on myself internally. And that's something we're all a work in progress. This is a journey for everybody. I mean, even as, you know, I classify myself as an expert in this space now, I'm still learning every day. This is why I enjoy being in spaces like this and working, especially with our higher education institutions, because we are producing the next leaders, right? So if we don't get it right in this space before they get out into the real world, we're just going to keep kind of like having this continuous kind of like repeating of the history. So I got to take this time to like say, like, and I also, you know, I think we also have been trained to, and this is my last comment, we have been trained to kind of like suppress some of our feelings as Black people, that, you know, it's not okay to say, I don't like what you just said to me, or, you know, that's making me feel a little, not uncomfortable, but angry. Because I always say, I'm not going to say uncomfortable, because I always say nobody has the right to be comfortable. So, you know, if you're uncomfortable, that's your problem. It's not my problem. But what you just said, you know, it came across like this, and you should be able to talk through that, you know, not in a defensive or negative way, but like, hey, what did you mean by that? And we're seeing a lot more of that now, where people are being put on blast when they're saying crazy stuff. They're losing their jobs, they get fired, and that's good. You know, in some cases, I think there's some things that are to the extreme. It just depends on the situation. However, some of these things are making people to second guess what they're going to say. But unfortunately, for the past 4 years prior to the current administration, we were put in an environment where it was kind of like a free-for-all. And stuff that people were thinking before, it was now free to say. And I think during the pandemic, people just lost their minds and started saying even more because they were doing it on a computer. So they're like, shoot, I'm just going to say it. I don't have nothing else to do. You know, the world might end tomorrow, so let me get off my chest now. So they just start saying anything. But we have to, you know, we have to have a counter narrative to let folks know that those days are over. You are going to respect us, right? You're not going to talk to us any kind of way. And we're not going to suppress our emotions like we've been trained to do. I'm going to turn things back over to Dean Williams for the closing remarks, because I know we only have 3 minutes remaining.
Yes, and thank you so much, Dr. Hutchings. This certainly was food for our soul, and it's true to the moment. I have my bag lunch here. I figure you all didn't want to see me eating on camera, so I was going to wait until the program is over. But hopefully you all not only got to get some lunch, but you were also able to get some knowledge. I certainly have all of the years' experience and different type of battles that you have fought and won. And I know you didn't mention all of them, but if you all are local to the area, you have followed all of the battles that Dr. Hutchings has won in his community that I'm extremely proud of and have in several conversations within my educational circles. So please know that I am proud to have you as a colleague, and certainly proud to have you kick off our Bison Education Week. So please join me in adding to your avatars the reactions of applauding Dr. Hutchings as we would in person. We appreciate you. We appreciate you. And with that, we're going to close out the program, and we hope to see you all for the remainder of the week. And if we don't see you at one of our programs, we hope to see you on social media as we continue to uplift education and educators that serve within the profession. Have a good day, everyone.